All right, so bank management, this is now chapter 3. We started last time on chapter 3, and I'll make a quick summary of what we do. So on slide 4, we said that commercial banks are the main supplier of credit in the economy. Then we said that's on slide 7, one of the main ideas is that the structure of a financial institution follows the functions, depending on what the functions are and what the services that they offer. Then we have slide 9 about community banks, which are also retail banks. They're relatively small, have a small number of services, small number of customers. They know the customer well, his job, his family, and there is a close communication between top management and lower level management. Occasionally, the customer will even talk to management. They depend heavily on the local economy because it's a community bank. Its main operation is in the city or in the neighborhood, and therefore it will depend on the health of the local economy. These, as a number, are shrinking and losing ground to big banks. The reason is that the financial system has been designed to be unfair. It's designed to favor big banks at the expense of small banks. Then you have the larger banks, which are sometimes called money center banks. They can occasionally call them full service banks, and full service banks will offer all services across the board. So they'll offer everything and anything. That's an important piece. They are better diversified and they can withstand any kind of economic stress, especially in one country when other countries are relatively healthy. Of course, if you have a global synchronized downturn, even the big banks are in trouble, except that the central bank will bail them out when they get in serious trouble. That was 11. Next one is trends in organization, right? That's 13. They become more complex. They add constantly new services.
Okay.
They add constantly new facilities.
What technology?
The big change is automation, automated accounting, and computerization. Another big characteristic is web services.
Okay.
And they also include now a lot of call centers. So instead of maintaining 10, 20, or 100 smaller offices, they offer a big call center where you make a phone call and they try as much as they can to solve your banking problem over the phone as opposed to going over there. Going over there costs you time, effort, money, driving. For them, it costs them maintaining office personnel. The call office is a lot cheaper. And they can outsource it to India or the Philippines.
Okay.
So that can make it 5 times cheaper or 10 times cheaper.
Okay.
Next slide, we can skip their banks with banks that's specific to the United States. They can be insured, uninsured, national banks, member banks. I won't be covering that much. Next, we skip 15 and we go to slide 16. Slide 16 is about unit bank. It's very simple, a bank with one branch, one office. Everything is in one place. There are no many branches, just one. They are first the oldest. That's how all banks usually begin. They just begin with one branch, one office. Everyone's in there. And if they grow, if they make profits, they can expand and open a second branch and a third branch. And that process of adding extra branches is called branching. Okay? They offer just a few limited services. Of course, they got one branch, maybe they work 5, 10, 20 people, that's it. They can't offer a whole bunch of stuff. Just a few things, okay? Their number is large because even though many of these banks fail, most of them fail, you constantly have new banks being born. So every year, about 2 or 3 banks go bankrupt, and yet again 2 or 3 more thousand banks will be again formed. Okay, it's interesting that at least in the U.S. and they'll tell me how it's in the other side of the world. Customers prefer to have a small bank with a personalized service. You go in the bank, you know who are the 2 or 3 people that service. You know who the manager is. These people know you. The manager knows you. So that's a personalized service. This is what they sometimes call a neighborhood bank. That's the bank in the neighborhood, okay? And most banks start out, and if they're successful, they move on. Next is slide number 18, branching slide. 18. Branching organizations. And with a branching organization, you're going to have a main office. Main office. Sometimes they call it head office. Head office. Which usually offers all the services of the bank. I mean, there's still going to be a small number of services. And then they have just branches. Two, three, five, as many branches, but not too many. Sometimes they call it home office, and sometimes if it's a bigger one, they'll call it headquarters. Headquarters.
What about the weather office? Weather office.
What office?
Weather.
Well, yeah, mother office, but they never call it mother office. It's called head office or head quarters. I've never heard about mother office.
Actually, I heard about mother office.
Right. I have never heard it in so many years. Now, there is a parent or mother company, and then there is a daughter company. That's an international finance,
and it relates to the company. It relates to an international
MNC, multinational corporation,
but not for a branch of a bank. All right. And one of the trends, the typical trend, is the branching. James, expansion. When times are good, these expand. If management is good, these expand. Most of these are scams. Many of these are just a bunch of guys get together and say, hey, how can we make a lot of money? Quick and easy way, we form our own bank, and then we take people's money. And then we somehow waste it and we go bankrupt,
okay?
And we get to keep the money. So many of these are fraud. Many of these aren't really intended. They never intended to be a good bank, okay? They just intended to make quick and easy money. And some of them are actually good, honest, competent, and over time they expand, okay? And they talk a lot about it, but it's an American phenomenon. The expansion, that's slide 20. All right. Now, a brand new thing which is happening, and they call it electronic branching. Now, in the book they call it electronic branching, but I kind of thought for a while, I read for a while, it's a little better to say electronic banking, where they offer banking services online, mainly online. There are a few purely internet banks or electronic banks without an office, but they don't work very well because people are afraid of an internet bank where you don't have an office. So you send them your money, and then if something happens, how do you get your money? Where do you go? You complain to whom? You see, there's no place to go. There's nobody to ask. It's like it vanishes, it disappears. It's somewhere on the internet, you know. So people don't trust purely internet or electronic banks. But electronic banking or branching could be for a bank that has a physical office, and then they try somehow to expand their business, but there is still an office somewhere. If things go horribly wrong or it's just not happening, you can still go to the office and actually see the people there. Okay, so that's a possibility. So they call them electronic branches, internet banking services as you apply for a loan online. Internet banking, maybe you can online make a payment, make a money transfer. It could be other stuff like automated teller machines, like ATMs, okay? So they just put in an ATM, you take your money in and all out. And they have some, virtual banks and all other stuff. That was slide 22. Chapter 3, slide 22. Next. Chapter 3, slide 24. Organizational structure. Well, a new thing in the United States, but relatively already popular in Europe and Japan, and
should just know the term, the name, because it's a legal name. You simply call the
bank
holding company.
Bank
holding company.
Slide 24.
Right here.
Just mention the slides only. Yeah?
Okay. Well, I'm doing my thing, you follow. So right now I'm on 24.
Okay.
And it's simply a corporation. It is not a bank. Notice that a bank holding company is not a bank. It is a corporation that owns a bank. So it's a corporate structure, and it may own one company, two company, three companies. It may own one bank, it may own two banks, it may own three banks, okay? So it may own a bank and a company, it may own two banks, it may own a bank and five companies, okay? Now, the question is, why? What's the reason to have a bank holding company? Well, you own both the bank and a number of corporations. So, if you have your businesses and you have a bank, the businesses can get better financing. Better financing for your businesses.
For example, if you have a government.
But we're just trying to understand why you'll have a holding company.
Yeah, yes, yeah, they have all holding company, holding banks company.
Right.
To finance their
operations. So better financing.
Better financing, easy financing.
Right, easier financing. What else? Sometimes there is higher leverage. Higher leverage means higher financial leverage. You study it from corporate finance, means higher risk and higher profits and higher profitability. If it works well, the profits are much higher. There could be also in the US at least tax advantage. And it also allows for business expansion. It's better and easier to expand into other non-banking businesses. So you can use your businesses to help your bank with deposits and banking and all the other stuff. And you can use the bank to help the businesses. And there is a very similar structure in Japan and similar banking structures in South Korea, but we're not going to discuss at least those now. For now, we just need to understand what it is
pocket,
and what
pocket.
Are some of the benefits.
I say pocket to pocket.
From one corner, yes. So these bank holding companies could have literally one bank company. So, you could have a one bank company. This is a bank holding company which has only one bank. It may have 10, 20, or 100 other businesses, but it's just one bank.
Okay.
And it could be multi-bank. Now, related to this part here,
You may have, if a bank is a part of a bank holding company, it's called affiliated bank. So again, I'm expecting you to know and understand the words and the names. Affiliated bank. Is a bank which belongs to a bank holding company. If it does not, it becomes independent. So, a bank is either affiliated or independent. It is impossible to be both at the same time. It's the one or the other, okay? There's no other way. Next, skip 27. You can take a look at the picture of 28. Just look at the picture, what a structure is of a multi-bank holding company, what the picture looks like. It's just a holding company, one business, two businesses, one bank, two bank. Just basic, straightforward stuff. So, what are some of the claimed benefits related to these holding companies? That's slide 29. So, some people say, oh, these banks are a lot more efficient. Now, maybe true, maybe not true, but they say we're a lot more efficient. They also say, oh, we offer more services. That's, of course, true. If you have 2, 3, 4 banks, you're obviously going to have more services. What else do they say? They say profits are higher and more stable. Maybe true, maybe not true. If they're more efficient, likely profits will be higher. But if they're less efficient, profits will likely be lower. Okay. Oh, okay. Well, here's the thing. One of the claims, and it's probably true and correct, you have a big bank holding company, you concentrate too many banking resources and too much capital into these big banks. The result is that the smaller community banks don't get enough capital. In other words, community banks get drained out of resources. They don't get sufficient resources. Some people actually prefer, for example, my dad, to put his money in the biggest possible bank for the wrong reason, believing that if it's bigger means better. Certainly not true. Bigger doesn't mean. He also believes that, well, that's very true now, that if it's bigger and the bank goes bankrupt, the government will save the bank. That's true, and now in banking, that's actually money in banking, we can discuss a very different phenomenon. Phenomenon of mega banks. A mega bank is like in Europe, Deutsche Bank. And Deutsche Bank is the biggest European bank. Biggest German bank, and it is 10 times bigger than the German government. If the bank goes bankrupt, the government is too small to bail it out. It just can't. It doesn't have the resources. Okay. So this is the problem with some of the biggest banks. The biggest banks have grown to be bigger than the government. So in this case, you have to pray that nothing bad happens because they're not same over. All right, so that's 29. Now on 30, it's very simple. It's only in the US, does not apply to others, is that now banks can cross borders and open in other states. Nothing very interesting here. In other words, the act, it's called Regal-Neal Act, allows, that's from 94, to open banks across other states. Not really interesting. Now, the next is more interesting and important. That's slide 31. And it can get very confusing a little bit. Even many years ago, I was a little bit confused about the names. This is called financial holding company. And for a while I was also confused because to me, bank holding company and financial holding company, they sounded the same. I mean, sure, they're both holding companies. And for a long time, I didn't make the difference. What's the difference between a bank company, holding company, and financial holding company? Well, there is a difference. In a financial holding company, it can hold banks and insurance companies and investment banking companies. So here a bank holding company holds banks, commercial banks, okay, 2, 3, 5, 10. Here it holds banks, as in commercial, plus insurance, plus investment banks, sometimes they call them securities firms. Securities firms involve investment banks, which are on the primary markets, issuing securities, and brokers, stock brokers, whatever other brokers. So all of these together. So see how they say it is a special type of holding company that may offer the broadest range of financial securities, including dealing in and underwriting securities. Dealing in and underwriting securities means this one, investment banking and brokerages, and should be also insurance, selling and underwriting insurance. So these are the three main types: commercial banking, insurance, and securities. So that's slide 31. Next one is slide 34. Okay, I'll go up here. In slide 34, the main idea is that commercial banking in general, the financial industry, is reshaped and restructured by mergers and acquisitions. During the last, especially 2-3 decades, banks are constantly grown. If a bank grows, it gets acquired or it merges with another bank. The concept is, there are many concepts, The biggest one is called Too Big to Fail. Too Big to Fail. You study?
What does it mean?
I'm explaining now for you. T, B, T, F. Too big to fail means the bank grows and grows and becomes bigger and becomes bigger and bigger. A lot of businesses depend on the bank. A lot of employees depend on the bank. A lot of depositors depend on the bank. The bank becomes critical. The bank becomes very important for the economy. It becomes so important that if the bank goes bankrupt, the whole banking system and the whole economy will crash with it. In other words, thousands of businesses will go bankrupt. Tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands of people will lose their deposit. So it's going to be a complete disaster. Well, the government will never allow a complete financial disaster. So what will the government do? It will bail out the bank. In other words, they will print the money and give it to the bank for free or almost free. Or they will borrow from a foreign country and give it to the bank. Now, this happened many years ago in my home country, Bulgaria, had a big bank, the third biggest in the country. They call it First Investment Bank. It's very easy to go and go and say it's First Investment Bank. And a lot of rich people, a lot of famous people, they like, they put their money in the bank. Well, the bank was poorly run, went bankrupt. So the government borrowed huge amount of money for our country, borrowed like $2 billion to bail out the bank, which for a small country, that's an extraordinary amount of money. But they will never allow it to fail, because with it fail a lot of not only rich people, but a whole banking system, the whole economy. So a lot of banks that are small and mid-sized, if you're mid-sized, they may choose, if you get in trouble, for you to go bankrupt. Okay? But if you're big, they will never allow it to go bankrupt. So let's say you're the super big bank. The government will never ever allow you to have. But you're a mid-sized bank and say, you're not very important, you can go bankrupt. And you're also not very important because you're smaller men. And you also. So what the three of you guys do? You get together and you merge together. And now you're three times bigger, and now you're very likely, if you go bankrupt, the government to bail you out. Now you can do all sorts of stupid stuff and not having to worry about it, because no matter what happens, the government is gonna save you, okay? So this is one of the primary drivers between mergers and acquisitions, is the drive to get bigger. So too big to fail is the first main primary reason. The second one they claim is diversification. You're doing mostly corporate loans, you're doing mostly small consumer loans, you're doing mostly mortgages. These are supposedly somewhat unrelated. So if the three of you merge, you're more likely to be somewhat diversified or more diversified. So, diversification. In the third one, different services. You often offer 6 or 7 services, you offer 10, you offer 5, all three of you together will probably offer 20 or more. So, add more services, okay? And they say, wow, only in the US since 1980, in other words, for the last 30 years, 40 years, There have been over 12,000 mergers and acquisitions. 12,000. All right. So, next one. 35. The key characteristic here is that the financial industry in general,
both
in US, of course in UK,
all over Europe,
in China, Japan, and probably the Middle East, the trend is toward rising competition. Including competition from foreign banks. In other words, German banks opening in Bulgaria and in Italy. Italian banks opening in Germany and in Bulgaria. So, everywhere you face more banks, more competition. And on top of that, notice, you have, that's chapter one, credit unions. They compete with the banks compete with credit unions. Savings associations, same thing. They compete with the banks compete with them. Finance companies compete with banks compete with them. Insurance firms, they compete with the banks, again, not with the bank itself.
With the
financial holding company, which will have an insurance business, okay? They compete with or security dealers. Again, security dealers don't compete with banks, but they compete with financial holding companies that will have security dealers with them. Okay? And what else? Hedge funds. Of course, hedge funds compete with commercial banks. Bank competes with hedge funds. Why? Because if you're a multi-million rich person, have 5 million, you're probably going to put 3 million in the hedge fund, not in the commercial bank on a deposit. Why? That's it. Why? Let's say, get 5 million. Why would you put it in the hedge fund and not in the commercial bank? Why? You're a rich guy.
Yep.
5 million investable funds. You already have your cars, you already got the Maserati, you got the Lamborghini, you got the Ferrari, and I got 3 houses. And you don't want to buy 4, 5, or 6 houses.
How many wives?
Yeah, 4 wives. So you're at the limit. Now, having all 4 wives, 4 houses, you need to invest them. Would you put your money in a hedge fund or in a commercial bank?
Hedge fund, sure, man, not hedges.
All right, what was the short answer? The bank will give you 1%, maybe half. Hedge fund will invest in anything and everything for high risk. The hedge fund can give you 5, 8, 10, 15. If the hedge fund is good and you're lucky, you could easily get 10 or 12%.
Islamic way.
Well, we're not talking about Islamic or non-Islamic. We're talking about something amazingly simple.
Yeah.
The bank gives you little. The hedge fund is a
depends what is the revenue of the investment, then they will give you dividend.
Correct. So, it's a fund. It's an investment fund. It's similar to a mutual fund, but it's a fund. They buy stocks, bonds, real estate, all sorts of risky stuff. So, they got a chance to give you very high return.
Is it risky?
Or,
Again? Is it risky?
Or is it lose?
Yes, of course. This is the biggest, the first law of finance says that you cannot get higher return without higher risk. It's impossible. It's a law. Otherwise, everyone will go to get the higher return, and when everyone invests in higher return, the return calls. Okay.
Opportunity cost.
Yes, there is an opportunity cost. So, financial institutions compete big time with hedge funds, and hedge funds compete with financial institutions and banks. Okay. And again, for all of these reasons, I wrote it in big letters last time at the last chapter one, at the last slide. For all of these reasons related to the mergers and acquisitions, they begin to look alike. And anybody remember how to call it when financial institutions begin to look alike, to offer the same types of services and all the other stuff? It's called, on quiz number one, convergence. Okay, so they offer more services, usually by acquiring another business. So you're a bank, instead of offering now insurance and all, you just buy an insurance company through a financial holding company. Okay, so he's doing mortgages, you're doing commercial loans, rather than you start doing all the mortgages, it's a lot easier to do the merger or acquisition. All right, next, let's see how much time. Okay, break here.